here today for a hearing in the matter CFI 26-2009 before the Deputy Chief Justice Sir John Chadwick. The claimant is represented by Hamdana Shamsi Lawyers and Legal Consultants. Lead counsel is Richard Hill QC and Sharif Shivji, assisted by Gail Hanlon. The defendants are represented by Alton Amy & Company. Lead counsel is Michael Brindle QC and Michael Black QC, assisted by Sarah Bayliss, Rita Jabella, and Robert Maxwell Marsh.
Yes, Mr. Hill.
May it please your lord. Lordship, could I just deal with some housekeeping matters first?
Well, if you've got a witness, haven't you?
Well, my lord, yes, I was going to make some opening remarks and summarise where we are, where we think we've got to on the issues in dispute, and then call Mr. Al-Faraf. Starting with housekeeping matters, we now have agreed the joint statement. That's just being copied now and will be handed to my lord in a moment.
This is the one that I ordered should be produced by the 25th of February.
My lord, that's right. You would have seen from my skeleton, we engaged in correspondence with the defendants. We thought in good time to allow that joint statement to be agreed, best part of 2 weeks to go, I think it was, and received nothing in response from them. Until we were hit on the day that skeletons and joint statement were due, we were hit with a KPMG report from them, and that was the first engagement by them with the issues that we had raised in correspondence. So in those circumstances, it is regrettable that the joint statement's late, but I have to say the fault lies at the door of the defendants rather than ours, but it is agreed now. And it is, I do say, a useful document for my lord when I hand it up.
It's well, it would have been if it had been produced when I asked for it to be produced.
My lord, yes.
As it is, I have had no opportunity to look at it. So no. Its use is seriously diminished.
My lord,
that was the intention of those who chose to delay it.
Well, my lord, it's certainly regrettable. I would say that the version that we provided to my lord, I think 2 days ago, which was in a draft markup, does still substantially encapsulate the issue. So if my lord had any time to look at that, it hasn't in substance actually moved on. It's just now agreed. So that would still have been a useful draft. The other housekeeping points, can I just check that a supplemental skeleton and a Griffin's report of 27th or 28th of February made its way to my lord just before my lord got on the aeroplane?
No. A number of documents were handed to me this morning.
Right.
Which I have. But I haven't had a chance to read them.
No, well, my lord, I...
I mean, this is a remarkable way to conduct litigation, if I may say so.
Well, again, all we...
I made an order.
Yes.
At the beginning of February.
Yes.
I might just as well have been beating the air for all the notice anybody's taken.
Well, my lord, all we've been able to do is respond to the KPMG report, and that, as I say, came in on the day that our submissions were due.
Well, the one thing I did order was that a witness should be made available for cross-examination.
Yes.
And that's what I want to hear.
Well, my lord, he is available for cross-examination.
Well, let's get on with him.
Yes, could I just then... understand the procedure that my lord envisages. What I had anticipated doing was essentially opening on my case on where we are on the outstanding points and issue, which have slimmed down considerably, then calling Mr. Al-Kharafi, and that would essentially be my presentation of my case. There would obviously then be, following the cross-examination, we would then essentially move to my learned friend's speeches. I don't know how, if my lord wants to hear Mr. Al-Kharafi right now,
well, I want to hear what Mr. Garafi has to say, because until I hear heard what Mr. Garafi has to say, I don't know what evidence I'm dealing with.
Well, my lord, the points Mr. Al-Kharafi deals with are, I would have thought, a relatively small part of the exercise that my lord
well,
now
let's
has.
Let's get it over with.
Well, that's
we've
fine.
We've got him in court, we've got an interpreter in court,
yes.
And they're all costing money.
My lord, yes. Well, we're getting him now. So he will be here imminently. We're told 15 minutes, my lord. He's in the Ritz-Carlton and he's coming now. But perhaps while he's on his way, I could just open on the points I was going to, but at least make the first of the points I was going to make by way of opening, so I don't have to repeat myself after Mr. Al-Qarafi.
Well, before Lanfin does it, your lordship probably doesn't want to hear an argument as to who is to blame for the late documentation, but certainly we don't accept it from our fault. I didn't think your lordship would, but just to note that we don't accept it from our fault, but we do accept your lordship's order has not been complied with as a matter of considerable regret.
Just to complete the housekeeping points, there is one further report from KPMG now, or at least a letter from KPMG, which has come in on behalf of the defendants this morning, and which, in the circumstances, we're not going to
object. I have made no order for an expert report, and so I'm not expecting to have any expert reports.
Well, my lord, yes, these reports have, I think on both sides would accept, ended up being a useful vehicle for narrowing the issues.
Well, if the parties wish to use them as a useful vehicle, then they can do so. But I have made no order for experts' reports.
No, but that's accepted on both sides. None of this is tendered as expert evidence on either side. It's all a vehicle for our presentation of our cases. And I think on both sides it's accepted that it's useful, and indeed it's led to a joint statement that has made quite a bit of progress. And I think both sides will be making submissions in terms of the outstanding issues by reference to those reports. But as I say, on the basis that these aren't experts' reports, this is the vehicle that both sides are using for their submissions. And on that point, KPMG have produced one this morning, and given the way in which these are being presented, we're not going to object to them using those arguments and using that report as a vehicle for their arguments. But I've only just seen it, and I have no problem with it going in, because my learned friend, Mr. Brindle, will be speaking on the basis of that report as things are, and we may as well have it in writing. So no doubt that will be handed up at some stage. Now, the order in which I'm going to deal with matters today, and I'll make as much progress as I can before Mr. Al-Qarafi arrives, and then continue after he's finished, if I may, is to deal with the outstanding quantification exercise first, where there are three heads of loss, those being first, fees and interest incurred of Bank Saracen, secondly, fees and interest incurred with ABK, and thirdly, interest incurred with CBK. Next, I'll deal with a very short point on interest, and next I'll deal with the issue of multiple damages against the first defendant under Article 40, subparagraph 2 of the Law of Remedies and Damages.
Well, you have dealt with all of these in your written submissions.
My lord, yes, but things have now moved on because we've had a yet further report from KPMG. We've had the joint statement.
How much use can I make of your written submissions?
Well, I hope quite a lot, my lord. But
why do I need to hear them again?
Well, because things have moved on, the issues have narrowed, and I can now deal with the outstanding issues. And I hope that it makes the exercise easier for my lord and shortens it.
Mr. Hill, it doesn't shorten it or make it easier if I'm given things at or almost at the time that I want them. I read them, and then I'm told I might as well not have bothered because things have now moved on.
Well, it's
if you're going to invite me to cross things out of your written submissions, then that would be helpful to know what I can cross out.
Well, The written submissions are still relevant. I was hoping to have an opportunity, and I do respectfully submit that it will assist my lord just to drill down into the outstanding points in issue.
I have long despaired of any prospect that either party has any intention of assisting me in this litigation.
Well, lord, I'm
the objective of both parties is to make it as difficult a task for the course as they can.
Well, that's certainly not our intention.
It's plain from the way in which the litigation is conducted.
Well, can I just say on our side of the court,
that's
certainly
the intention is that if you make it as difficult as possible for the court, there's a real chance that the court will make a mistake and you could appeal it.
Well,
certainly the basis on which this litigation is plainly being conducted.
On our side of the court, that's certainly not the case. We are trying to assist. These are quite knotty issues, some of them, the issues that arise between the accountants, which we have to drill down and get to the bottom of. And I'll certainly do the best
I can.
They've
been issues since December.
Oh, Lord, some of these have been issues only in the last day or two.
Well, that's because it's only in the last day or two people have turned their minds to. Underlying issues have been there since at least December.
Well, Lord, as I say, we have had to grapple with a report from KPMG which came in on Thursday, I think. We've done our best. Starting with the first head, which is fees and interest incurred with Bank Saracen, my Lord knows that this is the head of loss and judgment at paragraph 433. As we set out at paragraph 15 of our skeleton, we seek 10.578 million under that head. And there is, as we identify in that table, there is one relatively modest difference between the parties of $648,000, which I'll deal with in a moment. Separately to that, there is a further adjustment that the defendants contend for, which we also deal with in our skeleton of paragraph 18, which is an adjustment of a little over $3 million. Now, the starting point for all of these figures is the figure in the Griffin's report, which gives rise to our 10.578 million figure. One doesn't need to turn that up, but for the transcript, that's at bundle C141422, and that gave the figure at trial, which is still the figure we contend for. And that's reiterated, just to be clear, in Griffin's second report, and again for my Lord's reference, that's at C2, tab 48, page 856. And now, coming to the 2 points of difference, as things stood at trial, the only points of difference we were aware of were at Schedule Y to the second defendant's closing submissions, which again for the transcript is at E78, page 1479, and the difference, leaving aside a very small $444 item, entirely corresponded to this $648,000 item that one sees at paragraph 15, and I'll deal with that now. The difference here arises out of a point of principle which my Lord needs to resolve, which is whether one should, in calculating the damages due on the fees and interest from Bank Saracen, take account of the remaining debit balance on the third claimant's account with Bank Saracen. The claimants say one just ignores that. The defendants say you make a deduction from the damages in respect of that debit balance. Now, my Lord will look in vain for any coherent explanation anywhere in the defendant's skeletons or indeed the KPMG reports as to why they say one should make this deduction, and we say they are wrong for obvious reasons. The first is that as a matter of approach, they're comparing apples and oranges, because what my Lord is doing is looking at the costs that have been incurred on an expenditure basis. And it makes no sense to include in that calculation a balance sheet position, which is a debit balance on the claimant's part. But the simpler point is that their approach can lead to double counting in Saracen's favour. Saracen aren't saying we're not going to sue for that money against the third claimant or seek to set it off against the judgment or anything of that kind. They haven't said that. As matters stand, there is every prospect that they can and will rely on that debit balance in the future. And what my Lord is doing in the current exercise is assessing the damages that are due. And so one just ignores the fact that there is a resulting debit balance that C3 has with Saracen, and one simply calculates the damages, and the damages are all the interest expenditure. And it's completely separate. Questions about whether and when and how Saracen will pursue their existing debit balance against C3 are completely irrelevant and separate to the exercise of quantification. So that, my lord, deals with the main difference on the figures, or as they stood at trial, that is the difference between Schedule Y of the D2's closing submissions and the Griffin's report at trial. We then come to the other point of difference that arises under this head, which is that the defendants argue that there should be a further reduction in the fees and interest charges that we have claimed to cater for fees and interest in respect of lending or withdrawals on the accounts which they say are not directly related to the notes. And this is quite, this is a very important point of principle, which is probably the most, the biggest point of principle between us. And the big point, and it applies both to Saracen losses and indeed to ABK and CBK losses, the big point that my learned friends make is that there was a 35 million withdrawal by C2 and separately further withdrawals by C1, which the defendants quantify at 4.1 million. And their argument is that those withdrawals and any interest on those withdrawals and any consequence of those withdrawals need to be removed for the purposes of the quantification exercise. And on this particular part of the quantification exercise, the original suggestion from the defendants was that this had a 2.237 million impact. That was at Schedule Z of their closing submission, at Bundle E, tab 78, 1460. But what they now contend for is a higher impact on the Saracen fees, and they suggest that the actual impact is now 3.243 million, leading to a quantum figure, they say, of 6.68 million, as opposed to our 10.78 figure. Now, we have two answers to this big point of difference, one of principle and one on the numbers. My lord, and dealing first with the point of principle, we have already given credit for the principal amounts of these drawdowns. So we are not claiming the 35 million, for example. What we have not done, and what the question for my lord is whether credit also needs to be given for interest and fees associated with those particular drawdowns. We say it should not, and the reason for that is that this is a nil transaction case, as my lord has already decided and made clear beyond doubt in the October judgment. And we say on that basis the position is a straightforward one, which is that but for being put into this whole lending arrangement on the basis of a deal that Saracen said they could offer but couldn't, we would never have been drawing down these monies, and we simply wouldn't have entered into this borrowing. So both this 35 million figure and the 4.1 million C1 figure, we say this is borrowing which would never have been entered into but for the transactions which are impugned. And while we accept this doesn't entitle us to the principal for free, and that's why we've accounted for that, we do say we should not have been and should not be saddled with the incident, with the interest and fees, which are the incidents of this lending, which would never otherwise have happened. So that's the point of principle, my lord, and it cuts, and it's an important point for a number of the claims. The second point is, as I said, on the arithmetic of this, because if the court were minded,
where is the evidence that it never would have happened?
never would have happened. Well, my Lord, Mr. Alcaraffin will speak to that if it's challenged.
Is that in a witness statement?
It was his evidence at trial.
Well, you'll show it to me if you
want. I'll have to go and get references. But we certainly say that all of this borrowing is borrowing that wouldn't have happened.
Mr. Hill, I need to be careful in this exercise between what you say and what is actually supported by evidence. We're concerned to deal with the issues that were raised at trial and the evidence that was given at trial, supplemented by such evidence as has been properly admitted since.
No, I accept that.
So I shall need to see the evidence on which remains the case.
Yes, and I've made a note on that point. I will need to come back to my lawyer with a reference. Well, coming back to the point of principle, and then the difference on the numbers, this is something where I'm afraid my Lord does need the most recent rounds of reports to understand where the parties have now got to, but I can explain it and do it as a matter of submission if that helps.
Well, what I hope would be the case is that all of this would appear from a joint statement.
Well, it does.
So I could see.
Yes, it does.
A joint statement. What was agreed and what wasn't agreed. And that would be much the easiest way of trying to deal with it.
Well, I've just handed up what is now the agreed joint statement. I've just been dealing with fees and interest charged by Bank Saracen, which starts at paragraph 6 of the statement. And as I said, paragraph 7, there's the difference in quantification which I've referred to. And then paragraph 8 refers to the methodological difference.
Well, here it all is. This is what I wanted. If I'd had this when I'd asked for it, I would be better prepared to deal with this hearing. The parties didn't want me to be properly prepared for the hearing, so they didn't provide it. But I have it now.
Well, Lord, we certainly did want my Lord to be properly prepared for the hearing, and we don't accept that it's our responsibility that this is made. So, as paragraph 9 says, our position is we should reverse all these fees and interest. So that's the first sentence of the point I've just dealt with, the point of principle. I'm now coming on to what's dealt with in the next part. We say that even using the defendant's different methodology, the calculations are too low. And then we refer to computational errors, and then inconsistency of adoption of the methodology, and the wrongful reduction of a debit balance. The wrongful deduction of a debit balance of 644 I've already dealt with. So what I now need to deal with are those four other items, which is the 179, the 32,000, the 1.148 million, and the 354,000. And I'm going to deal with that now. Just before I do, it's worth looking at what the defendant's position is, which is that they do maintain their methodological point on deductions, and then they don't accept our adjustments on the numbers if one gets into that territory. And the references are then given at paragraphs 10 and 11. So if I could now deal with the four...
Well,
I see
when I look at paragraph 11 that the defendant's position is explained in a report dated the 2nd of March, so it's not particularly surprising that I wasn't given this statement when I asked for it on the 25th of February.
Indeed, the fourth KPMG report is itself dated 25th of February. So both reports...
So my order has just been completely ignored.
Well, we certainly criticise the defendants for that. Can I just come to the four components of the four components of these numerical difference, which, as I say, only arises if my Lord's against me on the methodological point. The first is a point which is made at paragraph 5.2 and 5.3 of Griffin's supplemental report. My Lord will have been given that this morning, I now understand. I don't know if that's in a bundle anywhere or whether my Lord only has it loose.
I have a loose document dated the 27th of February.
My Lord, yes. Just to be clear.
Which I received this morning.
Yes. That should in fact be dated 28th of February, so it's a 28th of February document. Now, at paragraph 5.2 and 5.3 of that report...
But this is unlikely to comment on a new document which is dated the 2nd of March.
No, my Lord, no. It does comment on the KPMG 4th report, which came in on the 25th of February. But it obviously, the last word is KPMG's of this morning. If one looks at paragraph 5.2...
Why shouldn't I simply adjourn the whole of these proceedings so that they come back to me at a time when I do have the material and have had time to look at it, that I made an order expecting to be complied with?
Well, Lord, obviously that's a course that's...
Well, I mean, I want to hear Mr. Carafi.
Yes.
Because Mr. Carafi's evidence doesn't seem to me to touch any of this matter. I want to hear Mr. Carafi. The parties have engineered a situation in which this matter is not ready for hearing today because they've chosen to disregard the orders that I made at the end of January.
Well, that is a cause open to my Lord. It obviously has profound costs.
If I do that, then I should obviously have to inquire into why that has happened, because it will have cost consequences.
Well, it would have cost consequences. From our part, we would also be a little concerned about the timing consequences, because it's been hard enough to get dates that my learned friends would find out.
No doubt that's been intentional.
I mean, if we all could be
otherwise, there is no explanation as to why my order wasn't complied with.
Well, we certainly do criticise learned friends for that.
It's difficult to look at these documents without an increasing sense that they're designed to sabotage this hearing.
Well,
the court is not getting the help and cooperation that it expected to get from parties represented by leading counsel in circumstances in which it held preliminary hearings to avoid just the situation that we're in today.
Well,
and that is deeply unsatisfactory.
I certainly accept and in fact submit that it is unsatisfactory. I also submit that this is to be laid wholly, if not all principally, at the door of the defendants and not my
Well, clients. I only have to look at the dates to see when things happen.
That's right, my Lord. But I would be concerned if matters moved off unless... Two things. One,
well, I do want to hear Mr. Carafi's evidence.
Well, he's on his way, my Lord. And
that is a missing piece of the jigsaw which we need to finish.
Yes. And can I also say, my Lord, that where we've now got to, regrettably very late, is that I think we are in a documentary shape for this hearing. Now that we actually have all these reports and we have the joint statement, we have finally got to the position that we should have got to a week or so ago. But that obviously puts my Lord in a very difficult position. And I also have to accept...
No doubt it was intended to.
And I also have to accept these are quite knotty points, some of them. And it's not easy, and won't be easy for my Lord to get to the bottom of them.
Yeah. Well, if you have a knotty point, spring it on the judge at the last minute, and there's a good chance you'll get it wrong.
I wonder if the thing to do is, can I keep going anyway until Mr. El-Khrafi
Well, Mr. Hill, you're obviously going to keep going anywhere, whatever I do.
Well, I certainly won't if I don't.
Trying to get a witness into the witness box.
Yes, and he's on his way. As soon as he comes, he'll go straight.
I do know how long it takes to get from the Ritz-Carlton to here, because I do it every day.
Oh, yes.
About 3 minutes.
Well, I don't know whether your lordship thinks it appropriate at this stage or not to respond to the suggestion that it's all the fault of the defendants, because we don't accept.
Well, I can see what documents are coming in dated the 2nd of March.
Well, that was a response.
These are documents which should have been in latest by the 25th of February.
Well, more the our submissions were deferred by the 25th of February, and the report of KPMG was, as your lordship said, it's not an expert report, this is simply effectively an aid to our submissions. That's how your lordship saw it. And although it's complained by my learned friend that this was unexpected and late, in fact it wasn't, we don't accept at all, there was a document which the parties, I think, put before your lordship, being a joint statement as it stood at that stage, which your lordship did receive. Since then, both parties have put in further material. Essentially, as Malone Trevor said, this has been to narrow rather than to broaden.
There is a document which complies with my order for a joint statement by the 25th of February, I would be pleased to see.
No, it doesn't, but I think the lordship had it. It doesn't comply with it.
There isn't a document which complies with my order.
But I think
you, Mr. Brindle, will know perfectly well why that order was made.
Well, yes, indeed.
And you will know perfectly well that it hasn't been complied with.
Yes, but well, that's not I do accept that. But I don't accept it was entirely the fault of my side, because it was just as much the fault of the other side, we submit. They themselves have put in the further Griffin material, which is the date of which I can't immediately recall, but I think it's the 28th. Of February.
Well, I also
so
have
that's
the document that has now been put before
and then
me as a joint statement on quantum.
Yes.
And I find it refers to a report of the 2nd of March.
Yes. The ordinance also, you see there, a report, Griffin's supplementary report of the 28th of February, in paragraph 10, which is from their side.
And I'm unable
so
to
both
understand
sides
why this material was not produced on time.
Nor it should have been. But my point is, it may not be a point that the lordship thinks matters for present purposes. It is not all our fault, it's their fault as well. Both parties have, in a sense, been late in what they have done, the matter that put before your lordship.
Yeah, well, both parties, no doubt, share a common purpose of making life as difficult to try as possible.
As my learned friend has said, we certainly have no such intention on our side. They've said they don't have any such intention. It is most regrettable. I fully understand and accept the attitude that your lordship has taken to this. In terms of going forward, I suggest that we, when Mr. Carafi comes, we have his evidence, your lordship wants to hear that. But it may be possible, your lordship, then, without hearing any submissions, to proceed with any other matters tomorrow. I don't think Mr. Carafi would be giving evidence more than half a day. And your lordship would have the opportunity, perhaps this afternoon, when we should be adjourned, to catch up on this material we should have had in the last week.
Well, I think we now have Mr. Carafi, so let's have him in the witness box.
Thank you.
العظيم
وكتاب الكريم
وكتاب الكريم
أن أقول الحق
أن أقول الحق
كل الحق
كل الحق
ولا شيء غير الحق
ولا شيء غير الحق.
I swear by Almighty God that I will give everything that I am about to give in the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. It's official time, David.
Could Mr. Al-Kharafi be given bundle B?
Mr. Hill, what I'm expecting to happen is that Mr. Kharafi is available for cross-examination on any additional material that he has put in. And I disallowed RAK4, so that's not a candidate.
Yes.
And on the hearsay evidence in Mr. Al-Shamji 1 and 2. Where the source of that hearsay was identified as Mr. Kharafi. And I'm expecting that to be the scale of the cross-examination.
Well, yes, I was actually going to just raise that point with my Lord. My Lord may have seen from the skeletons put in by the defendants that, slightly surprisingly, they're still seeking to run in this court various points on SAMCO and remoteness and so on, that my Lord has already determined.
I'm not expecting to get any help from Mr. Kharafi about SAMCO.
But, and there's issues on causation and foreseeability and remoteness, which has already been determined at trial in terms of whether they would have entered, Mr. Kharafi might have entered into alternative investments and so on. That is all water under the bridge from trial, which is being renewed on the appeal. I very much hope we're not going to see any questions of that sort, because obviously there's a live appeal on this, and I am concerned that my learned friends are going to seek to bolster their appeal in some way by questions asked in this process of Mr. Al-Kharafi. And I certainly respectfully submit that the questions should themselves be confined to the areas that Mr. Al-Kharafi can deal with.
I'm not contemplating deciding for a second time matters that I have already decided for a first time.
Well, we say submit the two, Lord. I'm grateful.
And therefore I shall not be expecting any evidence about it.
I'm grateful, Lord. If Mr. Al-Kharafi could be given, showing tab 32 of bundle B, starting at page 382. Do you see a document there entitled Fifth Witness Statement of Rafat Al-Kharafi? Could you turn to the last page of that document, which is page 386 of the bundle? Is that your signature? And is this your...
Yes, it's my signature.
And is this your fifth witness statement?
He said, for sure I cannot tell you, but I think this is the fifth one.
Yes, it is. And are its contents true?
Mr. Kurapi said it is written in English. That's why I could not tell it is the fifth, but it is. Yes, it is.
Are its contents true? Turn to tab 34, which starts at page 401.
Mr. Hill, before you leave page 286, it would be helpful if the witness could tell me the date on which he signed this document, because it's not dated on 286. It is on 382, but not on 386. You may have a copy which is dated, but
no,
on page 386 of my file, it hasn't got a date.
I don't know, but I think it was actually served on around the day it was around the 7th of January.
The witness can just tell us when he signed it, if he can.
And then, if you could now turn to page 401 in that bundle, tab 34. This document entitled Sixth Witness Statement of Rafin al-Gharafi. Is this your sixth witness statement?
Yes, it is my sixth statement.
And can you confirm whether that document was also signed on 7th of January?
And what I've heard of
Yes,
on the same day.
Thank you. Mr. Brindle and then possibly Mr. Black are going to ask you some questions.
My lord, it's the other way around. Just to tell you how Mr. Brindle and I have divided up cross-examination between us. I'm going to deal with a matter that's earlier in time, which is the matter that Mr. Hill first opened, namely the interest on the 35 million payments. My Lord will recollect that the payments themselves were dealt with at trial, and as Mr. Hill said, the interest is an issue for these hearings. So, my Lord, I'm just going to cross-examine Mr. Gharafi, first of all, on why those payments were made as a basis of the submissions that we will be making in due course, that the interest is not recoverable in these proceedings. So, my Lord, that's to explain what my part of the cross-examination is, and also to explain why one has to look back at some of the evidence at trial, that it is not I will not be re-challenging anything that was said at trial. It's on the basis of what the evidence that was given at trial and the purpose of those payments, my Lord. So that's my bit of the cross-examination. Then Mr. Brindle will take up the matter thereafter. Mr. Gharafi, can we just recap what my Lord found at trial? It's probably easier if I read just one paragraph from the judgment and the translator translates it for you. For the record, it's in bundle A, and we're looking at paragraph 72 of the judgment, which will be found on page 29. I'll read it slowly so that the interpreter can interpret it for you.
in February 2007, Mr. Qarafi recruited Alaa Taha as a financial advisor with the intention that Mr. Taha would assist him in raising finance for proposed real estate development in Kuwait.
إذا كان مكتوب وكان هذا الكلام أنا قلته فأنا هذا موجود وخلاص بس.
Yes, as far as you can remember, this one is 1 year and half back, and as long as it's written in the statement, yes, it is.
Yes, this is my lord's judgment. All I'm doing is reminding him. So all I'm asking is that you tell him what and interpret for him what the judge has found to be the facts of this case. So the learned judge carried on.
Okay, has the interpreter got a copy of the judgment in front of him?
Yes, Your Honour.
Yes, it's simply that rather than you reading it slowly so the interpreter can interpret what you're saying, make it quicker if the interpreter simply interprets into Arabic what's written down in the paragraph.
My lord, yes. So would you just translate paragraph 72 for 72?
72.
72. Mr. Qarafi, do you recollect telling us that you sent then Mr. Qarafi round a number of banks in Kuwait? Mr. Qarafi, do you recollect sending Mr. Taha then round a number of banks in Kuwait to see if money could be raised on your assets?
Yes,
I did.
And you recollect telling us that you had no previous relationship with ABK, but you said you had more than 20 bank accounts.
نعم، كان عندي في بنوك أخرى بعد الحساب. نعم.
And amongst the banks that you had accounts with in Q8 were the Gulf Bank and the Bergen Bank, weren't they? In fact, you told his lordship that you couldn't remember why you had an account with the Bergen Bank. Is that still the position?
Well, I think that's not the case. I was a captain of the court. No. You don't have to remember that you had a account with Bank Burhan, or not?
Well, can I just intervene? I do apologise for intervening. This, my lord may recall, Schedule X to my learned friend's closing submission. At trial, set out a list of all of the payments made by Mr. Al-Khurafi to entities such as Bergen Bank. And the questions, the area of cross-examination at trial on these very payments. So what my learned friend appears to be doing is going over again the very area that he's already traversed at trial, which is what was the reason for a number of payments made out of the accounts, whether to Bergen Bank or anywhere else. And
maybe he's not there yet. He's asking the witness if he can remember what he told me at trial, I think.
Well, that of itself demonstrates that what we're having is a rehash.
My lord, I'm not rehashing it. My learned friend will have the elementary courtesy to allow me to develop the question. Then he'll see where it's going.
We haven't got to a question yet.
We haven't.
Except along the lines, do you remember?
Well, my lord, yes.
Let's get to a question.
Well, my lord, the question... Well, I'll get precisely to it, if I may.
Now, you take your time, Mr. Black. It'll be quicker in the long run. You're not hassle.
Well, I'm grateful for that. Mr. Khurafi. The evidence at trial was that you paid $4 million... to Bergen Bank. Do you recollect I was cross-examining you about that?
My answer would be the same.
That you can't remember. And in fact, if
you cross-examine him about it, it will be on the transcript.
It is.
And if I want to know what his evidence was at the trial, I can see it on the transcript.
Yes.
And that's likely, if I may say so, to be much more accurate record of what his evidence was than his answer to you now as to whether he can remember what he said at the trial.
Well, my lord, what I'm trying to investigate is whether or not the submissions that are now made are based on anything other than the evidence that was said at trial by my learned friends, because their case is that these payments should be ignored in terms of interest, and that somehow they are causally linked to the impugned transactions, if I can call them.
But I haven't found or picked up yet anywhere in the fifth and sixth witness statements, which is effectively the new evidence, any reference to these transactions at all.
Well, there isn't, my lord.
Then where we are is what the evidence was at the trial, and you can make what you can of the evidence of the trial from the transcript. And trying to get this witness to tell me what he remembers about what he said at the trial is really not going to be very helpful. If I need to know what he said at the trial, I'll find it on the transcript. I mean, in case it helps, I've got no recollection of what he said at the trial other than what I put in my judgment or what I will read on the transcript.
My learned friend and
I expect the witness has a much busier life than I do, and therefore he probably has even less recollection of what he said at the trial.
Well, my learned friend is right, and I will take you to the schedule that actually schedules out the references on the transcript about what he said about each one of these payments, my lord. I obviously don't need to go back over that evidence.
The only recollection I have is that there were some Bugattis involved, which caught my interest.
There were Bugattis, and there were lorries, and the purchase of shareholdings, and many, many millions of dollars that the witness could remember what he'd done with. But my lord, as I say, will make submissions about those in due course. Well, Mr. Graffi, can I ask you this then? The money that you paid to these various banks, Bergen Bank, HSBC, and to the Gulf Bank, that we've heard the evidence about, we know that you bought some motor cars and you bought some lorries. The rest of it was just discharging liabilities in the normal course of your business, wasn't it?
موجود الورقة اللي أشوفها اللي أنا تكلمت فيها بالمحكمة أنا أقدر راجل أنا قلته بس أنا أعتقد إن في أشياء أنا ما أتذكر والله راحت معاشات راحت استثمار ما ماني متذكر يعني أنا أعتقد لما سألوني قلت أنا ماني متذكر فأنا حسب اللي قلته في المحكمة أنا ملتزم باللي قلته في المحكمة إذا الورقة موجودة فيها تفصيل أنا ملتزم هذا الكلام فسألوني عن سيارات قلت لهم نعم شريت سيارات بالنسبة للشاحن أنا ما أسوق شاحن يعني فهمت شركة واحدة من الشركات بس التفصيل الممل ما يعني يعطوني ورقة راح هذا يمكن أنا على نفس الموجود من الورقة
Mr. Rafi says he confirms what he stated before in the lordship's court before
yeah.
And as long as the list contains things he has mentioned then he confirms them but he cannot recollect what he has done in 2007 whether he bought cars or bought lorries or went around his usual business, this is what he does.
Yes. And if you were going to pay that money out, if you were borrowing it, you'd have to borrow it from somewhere, wouldn't you? Yes, I suppose you could rephrase better. If this was borrowed money that you were using, you'd have to borrow it from some bank, whether it was Saracen or any other bank.
أنا ما اقترضت هم اللي عطوا أنا حسب ما قلت بالمحكمة إنه أنا ما اقترضت هم جو وهذا الأخ روهت جاء لي إحنا نعطيك 35 مليون وهذا 35 مليون أنت تقدر تعتبرها إن أرباح مقدمة وهذا قلت في المحكمة الأولى وقلت له أنا ما أقدر أرجح المبلغ ولا أدفع فوائده قال يعتبر هذا دفعة تحت الحساب من أرباحك اللي إحنا وعدناك راح نحقق فيها هذا موجود في المحكمة.
Mr. Khurafi says at that point of time, he did not borrow anything. Saracen Bank came to him in the representation of Mr. Rohit. He came and he offered him voluntarily. He said to him, we wanted to give you the 35 million and you can consider it as advanced profits from the amount you will get later. And you can do whatever you want with that one. I told him frankly that I cannot repay these monies because I don't have it. He said to me, you don't have to, it is your profits, but we are giving it to you in advance. and I have stated this before in the court.
Well, you didn't say before you couldn't repay it. So are you saying that you didn't have the money otherwise?
أنا كان عندي 112 مليون معاه. فإذا عندي 112 مليون موجودة معاه بالاستثمارات، فزيادة فوق ال 112 كمان 35 أو 25 لأنه سحب منها 5. ف 112 مليون كانت موجودة أوريدي معاهم لمدة 3 سنوات، هذا مبلغ كاش كبير.
صح.
بس إذا at that point of time I have given Mr. Rohit $112 million as an investment to invest with Saracen Bank. So at that time I have offered amounts of money with them. So I do not need to borrow more.
I suggest to you, Mr. Graffi, that you knew you were borrowing monies from Bank Saracen, that you were discharging liabilities you had to discharge anyway, and that you knew that on the borrowed monies interest would be payable.
Just a moment, Mr. Blair, given that you're dealing with this through an interpreter, a question which, or an observation I suggest to you, which doesn't end up with a question,
yes,
isn't likely to produce an answer which is much help. If what you are saying is, it isn't true, is it? Then put it that way. But otherwise, the niceties of the commercial court in London are going to get lost. I know, because I have another life somewhere, that when counsel says, I suggest to you, it normally means, and you're telling a pack of lies. But if that's what you're going to put to the witness, given that we've got it all filtered through an interpreter, you've really got to put it there. Otherwise, we're not going to get a meaningful answer.
Okay. Mr. Karafi, you had debts that you had to pay to various banks, like Bergen Bank and Gulf Bank, didn't you?
هذا كلام مو صحيح. ما عندي ديون. الدين الوحيد اللي حصل لما صارت أزمة سارسن مع البنك الأهلي الكويتي، الملفات موجودة بالحكومة الكويتية وزارة العدل، ممكن نرجع حق وزارة العدل نجيب الملفات لقبل قضية الأهلي وسارسن.
I said I have no any debts with Gulf Bank or with Burkan Bank at that time, and you can refer to the minutes and the registrations with the Ministry of Justice in Kuwait and the Kuwaiti government, because before the case with Saracen and Ahli Bank of Kuwait, I did not have any problems at all.
Well, I suggest that's untrue, because you've paid many, many billions of dollars to Bergen Bank and Gulf Bank that you can't explain why you paid that money to them. And I suggest to you it's because you owed them that money.
لأنه أنا رجل أعمال وأدور فرص استثمارية من ضمنها شراء عقارات، معاشات موظفين، توسعات للعمل المالي. هذا يعني علشان يكون عندي دين لبنك في هناك مستندات، وزارة العدل الكويتية موجودة. إذا سعادة القاضي يحب أن أنا أرجع أدور مستندات وش كذا، أنا علي مديونيات كراتب خرافي في ذاك الوقت، أنا مستعد أروح أجيب المديونيات. إذا أنا شخص علي مديونيات راح تكون واضحة بوزارة العدل الكويتية والحكومة الكويتية.
Ministry of Justice in Kuwait and the Kuwaiti government, they have records of everything, but I did not have any debts. I was only going around and doing my usual business. I am a businessman. I have to pay salaries, I have to acquire new lands, I have to make new developments, I have to expand my companies. I was just going about my usual routine.
Well, if it was your usual
Saracen money for your normal business, weren't you?
نرجع للنقطة الأساسية. هذه ما يعني لما هي رهت في لندن وقال لي خذ هذا المبنى وقلت له ما أحتاج وعندي شاهد قاعد نفس محمد نور قلت له أنا ماني محتاج هذا المبلغ. قال لي هذا جزء من أرباحي فأنا لما يعطيني أرباح هي مو فلوسهم هم الفلوس أرباحي أنا. هو قال لي هذه أرباحك أنت هذا مقدم من الأرباح اللي إحنا راح نحقق لك إياه وقال لي إحنا ما نوعدك ب50% من الأرباح إحنا نوعدك ب40 وأقل. فهذا مقدم من الأرباح مالتك أنت تقدر تستخدمها. فلما واحد لما أخذ أرباح ما وسع شغلي ما أتكبر بشغلي أنا مهرجة مال.
Mr. Kurafi said that he was not speculating what he said to you. He had evidence that Mr. Rohit approached him and there is a witness who is sitting in this courtroom, Mr. Muhammad Noor. He was present at that time. When Mr. Rohit approached me and said to me, literally speaking, this is not money you are borrowing. This is your profits I am giving you in advance. And I am not, Mr. Rohit said to Mr. Kurafi, I am not promising you 50% profit. I can only promise you 40% and less. But this is your money I'm giving you in advance. So Mr. Kurafi says, I am a businessman. When I am presented with an opportunity to expand my business with my own money, I did not borrow anything. It's my own money, so I'm free to do with it whatever I do.
I suggest to you, sorry, Mr. Kurafi, you knew very well that you were borrowing money and that you had to pay interest on it, didn't you?
قالوا لك هذه الفلوس سلفة انت بتقترضها مننا وانت لازم تدفع عليها ارباح.
جاوبت هذا السؤال من قبل شوي.
He said, I have answered this question just a minute ago.
No more questions. Mr. Al-Kharafi, I want to ask you questions on a different topic. I want to ask you first of all about the interest and charges that you and the other claimants have paid to ABK. Your position is that you are now, when I say you, I mean the claimants, you are now claiming interest paid both before and after December 2009.
Is that right?
قبل 2009 أو بعد 2009 أنا المعلومة عندي العنوان العريض تفاصيل موجودة عند الموظفين المالوكي المسؤولين الماليين المكتب مالي فأكون أكون دقيق بالإجابة وصريح. ما عندي جواب دقيق بس إحنا اللي قاعد نطالب الموجود عند المحامين هو صحيح. هل أنا أعلم بتفاصيل المواضيع؟
Mr. Kurafi says that you well know that you and the other plaintiffs, they have stated everything in details with the lawyers in the submission to the court. But sitting here, you cannot recollect each and every minute detail about the claims.
Yeah.
But Mr. Kurafi says, I am a business owner, but I don't do the details.
No, but you're aware, aren't you, that you are claiming interest paid both before and after December 2009.
لكن انت الان اكيد تعرف يعني انه في انتم مطالبين الان بحقوقكم وارباحكم من قبل 2009 وبعد 2009. هل هذه المعلومه انت
صحيحه؟
Yes.
Up until the trial of this matter, the claim was only for interest up to December 2009 and not thereafter. Is that right?
قبل ما تجي للمحكمه هنا كانت كل مطالباتكم بتقول بان الارباح اللي بعد 2009 بتضل على هذا الكلام صحيح ولا لا؟
Can I show you something? If you be given bundle E, '73, it's the short passage I want to show you. Page, if you've got bundle E, it's tab 73, and almost at the end of that, near the tab 74, is page 1281. So if you could have that, but also page 1201 is the beginning of this document. You've got the wrong bundle, I think. Yes, it's bundle E. You've got the wrong bundle, I'm sorry. Go first of all to page 1201, the beginning of tab 73 in bundle E, please. Start at 1201 so you can identify the document. Now, what this document is the claimants, that's your side's, opening submissions for the trial.
Right.
If you then go to page 1281, please. This is what your lawyers said. Look at paragraph 198.3. The claim is for other fees and interest charged by ABK up to 19th December 2009. See that? That's why I asked you, Mr. Al-Qarafi, at the trial, that was all you were asking.
بس هذا اللي طلبته فيه ما طلبته قبل
انا بعدين مثل القاضي انا المحامي مالي اللي كان ماسك القضيه توفى فهو مش موجود الحين بس انا مع المحامي المرحوم حصل في نقاش لمده فتره طويله جدا على هذه التفاصيل التفاصيل الماليه يعني بوجه عام فانا بلغت المحامي مالي اكثر من مره بوجود أشخاص كثيرين. استرجم الحين عشان أكمل القضية.
Your lordship, he wanted to address this point to you yourself. He said, Your lordship, that at that point of time, the lawyer hired by Mr. Al-Qarafi, and Mr. Al-Qarafi had many discussions with him, but unfortunately, this lawyer passed away. Okay, and now Mr. Al-Qarafi wanted to continue for the second point.
بالنسبة لنقاشي مع المرحوم كاشف. كان إن أنا معاكم على خلاف وكان هذا الخلاف بحضور ناس كثيرة إن أنا كنت أقول له إن مطالبتنا فيها أكثر من جزء كان هو دائما يقول لي إن هذه الموضوع المحكمة في أولى وبعدين في محكمة هاي المطالبات.
He said at that point of time when he was discussing with the late lawyer Mr. Kashif. Mr. Qarafi had a disagreement with him. Mr. Qarafi said to Mr. Late Kashif that our claim...
Sounds like Mr. Qarafi should be telling me about what conversations he had with the lawyer. The position is actually much clearer if he's put... Mr. Brindle has not taken him to paragraph 201.
I'm not securing that on what I meant.
But it's dealt with in my judgment. What the purpose of taking Mr. Qarafi to to his lawyer's opening statement is will no doubt become clear in a moment, but it will become a bit clearer if I look at all of it.
Well, I was immediately going to go to 201 net, and I go to 201, please.
And you'll find these points are rehearsed in my judgment.
But Lord, I'm going to challenge this.
Can I explain to Mr. Corrado what you said?
Yes, please do.
سألني ليش طلبت المبلغ؟
yes.
أنا ما طلبت المبلغ ولا عندي علم شو طلبوا فيه. قاعد تفكر لي فصل بس.
طبعا. Okay.
Now, could you look at 201, please? The paragraph 201 on the same page. Could you translate that to him, please? Now, it's not true, is it, that losses were only calculated up to 14th December because you only had account statements up to that point? That is not correct, is it? Yes, it is not true, I suggest to you, that the reason why losses are calculated only up to the 14th of December was because you only had account statements up to this point. It is not correct, I suggest to you.
لك هذه النقطة المذكورة هو بيقول إنها مش صحيح. ليش؟ لأنه الأرباح اللي محسوبة فيها حتى 14 ديسمبر 2009 وإنه كان مفروض أنت قلت هذه محسوبة لحد هذا التاريخ. فقط لأنه عندكم بس كشوفات بحال هذا التاريخ.
ولا مفاهمش.
والله
ما فهمت ولا شيء. مفاهم.
You said you cannot understand your question.
I'm suggesting to you that first sentence is wrong.
أقول لك أنت بتقول إنه الكشوفات والخسائر هذه محسوبة لحد 14 ديسمبر.
كشوفات ولا خسائر. في فرق. الكشوفات فإحنا مع الأهلي في قضية.
نعم.
فهم وقفوا كل الكشوفات. إذا بالنسبة للخسائر خسائر مستمرة لها اللحظة إلى الآن في علي قضايا وحجوزات وانترست وفوائد كل هذا محسوب الحين ما وقف إلى الآن لم يوقف بالنسبة للكشوفات تعاملنا معهم صار خصم هو بمحكمة وقف لي كل الأوراق عليه
Mr. Kurama said let me explain something to you there are two things here we have the statements and we have the losses The losses are continuous up to today's date because we are in litigation with the Ahli Bank of Kuwait up to today and we are incurring losses. But if you speak about the statements, when we enter into a litigation with Ahli Bank of Kuwait, they stop giving us any statements. So at that point of time, this is the latest we have. We could not obtain more statements.
Well, I'm going to come to the detail of the statements in a moment. What I'm going to suggest to you is that the true reason why you didn't claim beyond 14th December 2009 was because you realised full well that you couldn't sensibly blame any later interest payments on the defendants.
لحد هذاك الوقت 14 ديسمبر 2009 كانت لأنه can you repeat please
yes the true reason you didn't claim beyond 14th December 2009 was that you realised that you could not sensibly blame any later payments on the defendants that's what I suggest to you
قال لك يعني هو بيقول انتوا حددتوا هذا التاريخ 14 ديسمبر 2009 لانكم عرفتوا انه مش من المنطق انكم تطالبوا بالخسائر الثانيه من البنك الاهلي الكويت بعد هذا التاريخ، لانه ما ممكن تلوموا عليها الحكومه بالضبط
اللي هو سارسون يعني.
سارسون
زين، انا البنك الاهلي قبل ما فلوسنا تتحول لبنك سارسون ما كان في قضيه معهم. لما بدات المشكله هم طالبونا بالمبالغ اللي اعطونا اياها حق سارسون، يعني قضيه سهله جدا، 1+1=2، احنا اعطيناها فلوس حق سارسون، راح فلوس سارسون، سارسون ما راح يرجعها، انت رجعها لي. فانا الكفاله البنكيه لازم انا ارجعها باسم زوجتي، لازم انا ارجع قرض الوالده والقرض مالي. وبسبب هذا اصلا كل شغلي مع البنك الاهلي كله وقف. فانا فلوس لحد الان اللي موجوده في رسل في سلسة ما رجعت. القضيه شغاله لان يبون فلوسهم يا جماعه.
He said this point is very clear to him. It's 1+1=2 for him. He was approached by Saracen to go and borrow banks from Ahli Bank of Kuwait and give to Saracen. When Saracen did not return the money to Mr. Qurafi, then Ahli Bank of Kuwait said to Mr. Qurafi, you need to give us back our money. Then when he couldn't, him and his wife and his mother, they could not, then the Ahli Bank of Kuwait filed the case against them. And up to now it is going on.
Let me ask you this. When, first of all, will you accept this, that the Saracen investments, the investments that you had acquired from Saracen, were sold in October 2008?
وما كان في علاقه، كان في مراسلات. فاذا كان في جواب يعني رساله منهم ان احنا بعنا هذا الاستثمار، هذا جواب مكتوب كتاب موجود في السجلات، لان انا شخصيا ما متذكر امتى باعه ولا.
Said I cannot remember exactly the date, but if there is evidence that because we had no direct communication with Saracen at that time, there were only communications through letters and emails.
Right.
And if there is a proof in the court record, then it is.
Okay. Now, can you help me with this? After the investments had been sold, interest continued to be paid, as you have said, to ADK,
right?
أنا دفعت بديت أدفع فوائد لأن سارس وقف الكوبونات من قبلها بفترة، فأنا بس وقف هو يدفع الكوبون أنا بديت أدفع فوائد. هي يعني هو دفع مرة مرتين وباقي أنا كله كيف دفعته.
He said actually Saracen and Bank stopped paying the coupons long time ago before that. They only paid once or twice, and from that time on I started making the payments to Ahli Bank of Kuwait.
And you and your mother, I think, tell me if you accept this, continued, I'm not asking about your wife at the moment, she's different, but you and your mother continued paying interest to ABK until
September 2010.
Is that right? I said, كنت الوالدة ما كانت تدفع، يعني كنت أنا الوالدة اللي تدفع الفوائد. كله صحيح.
Yes, that's right.
That's right. And then we know that you then had what we call the refinancing with CBK came thereafter.
وبعد ذلك عملت إعادة تمويل مع البنك CBK البنك التجاري الكويتي.
في هيريش.
You can say yes or no.
قال لك نعم ولا لا.
إيه بس في تفاصيل، ما في تفاصيل، ما عندي مانع جواب نعم، بس في تفاصيل.
He said the answer is yes, but he has more details.
Yes, I'm sure, but I'm coming back to it.
Sure.
Now, if you look at that period from October 2008, when we say that the notes, the investments were sold, until September 2010, when you and your mother were continuing to pay interest to ABK, I want to look at that period.
Okay. راح أتكلم عن فترة من 2008. حتى سنة 2010 كنت كنت دفعت دول والد الله حصار فوائد من البنك الأهلي الكويتي.
Right?
Yes.
Now, please can you answer this? Why were you and your mother not able to pay off
any indebtedness that you still had to ABK during that period? Why did you continue to pay interest? Why didn't you pay off whatever you owed them?
في سببين. في عندنا يعني احنا الحمد لله منصورين حال اغنياء بس احنا مو بليونيري. شغله ثانيه كان وقت الازمه الماليه في جميع الاصول نزلت للنص واكثر من النص. فلو كان عندنا قدره كان سجلنا بس كنا عندنا عجز. في نفس الوقت لما بدات المشاكل بدا الضغط من المشاكل من سيرتي ومن اهلي والازمه الماليه كانت كل الجوانب كان وضع سيء جدا.
سوري.
كان وضع سيء جدا. فلما يكون عندك انت 112 مليون في جهه ما عندك بعد 112 مليون ثانيه تسددها.
صح.
الا اذا كنت يعني شخص ملياردير.
صح.
Mr. Corafio said the reason for that is twofold. The first one that it is correct that they are well off, he and his mother, they are well off, but he said we are not billionaires. We have enough money, but we are not billionaires. So imagine that he said you have 112 million with Saracen Bank. And at the same time, I could not have another 112 million at the same time to pay off my debt to Ahli Bank of Kuwait. That's one reason. The second reason is that at that point of time, they had many assets in Kuwait and elsewhere, he and his mother. But at that time, there was a financial crisis was going on, and it started, and most of their assets were devaluated, maybe to half of their value. So at that time of time, point of time, it was a little bit tight with them. And that's the reason.
But even if they were worth half of their value, you still had plenty to enable you to repay this debt, didn't you?
And the captain of مثلا تقييمها بيساوي لازم الحد النص تقريبا دي السفرات كافية اللي كنت تدفعوا اللي عليهم تخلص منه
قولي يا ريت
I said to you I wish it was
Can you just show the bundle B please which is where your witness statements are bundle B Just before the witness statements that you've been asked about, there's another witness statement put in by your solicitor, Ms. Hanlon, at tab 26. Tab 26 starts with page number 331-1.
This is not his evidence.
No. Now you see that 331-1 is the beginning of this. And this is a witness statement of your solicitor in relation to the question of whether there should be a stay of the judgment and whether or not the claimants would be able to repay any monies to the defendants in the event of an appeal. You just translate that so he knows what it was.
I think it's only fair to ask him if he's ever seen it before.
Yes. Have you ever seen it before?
هل هذا مستمر عليك؟
شو هذا مستمر؟
عبارة عن وثيقة قدمها محمد داعش للمحكمة.
أي تاريخ هذا؟
تاريخ 12/11/2010.
أوكي. شو يقول هذا؟
يقول انه يعني محامين بضاعه يقول انه اذا في اي استئناف صار في هذه القضيه فانتم ما راح تقدروا تدفعوا اي شيء في الاستئناف هذا يعني ما في فايده يعني يعني الاستئناف القضيه اللي انتم تفضل الحاكم يحكم فيها بعديها اسوي استئناف عليها
يعني
هذا الاستئناف اذا صار في حكم ضدكم فانتم المحامين بتاعكم ما راح تدفعوا اي شيء
المغزى يعني
يعني
ابي افهم
السؤال
عشان
اجاوب. Can you explicitly explain to him what is the point of your question? Why are you showing him this one?
I haven't got to that. I just
Can we just
just have the answer. Has he ever seen this document before? It's dated November 2014. Has he ever seen this document?
He said he doesn't know.
The point of my question, he probably doesn't know, correct? But have you translated to him what I'm telling you the affidavit or the witness statement was for? The point of this statement was to say that the claimants had plenty of money so that they would be able to repay the defendants if the defendants' appeal succeeded. Can you just tell him that?
Now, Mr. Rahman says, when you speak about the appeal, did you mean that they are going to ask us to pay them money or what? Who will pay who?
If the appeal succeeds, then monies which have been paid to the claimants would have to be paid back to the defendants. Right? And in that event, this statement is saying the claimants could repay because they are very wealthy. And I'll show you the passage in a moment.
Okay. All right. يبقى يوصل لنقطة معينة يقول فيها إنه الآن في استئناف.
نعم.
هذا القضية الآن عدت المرحلة الأولى صارت مرحلة الاستئناف.
نعم.
إذا الطرف الثاني ربح الاستئناف هذا فلازم تدفعوا لهم فلوس.
أي فلوس؟
الفلوس اللي حكم لكم بها القاضي أول.
بس إحنا الحال إن الآن ما استلمنا فلوس منهم. يعني أنت قصدك تقول
لا هو اللي قصده يقول انه
هو قصده يقول ان احنا اعطونا فلوس عينهم
لا هو قصده يقول انه انتم عندكم فلوس كثيره اذا صار قضيه تدفعوا ما في مشكله
ندفع شنو يعني هم الحين احنا رافعين قضيه عليهم نبي فلوسنا اللي راحت عندهم الحين اذا انا خسرت راح اجي اعطيهم 812 مليون
مستر كرافي says he cannot get your point because the court case is that Mr. Kurafi has filed a case against your company saying that they have given them 112 million.
Yes.
So in case there is an appeal and the other party won and Mr. Kurafi lost, did you mean that Mr. Kurafi is going to pay them another 112 million?
That he would have to pay back the damages which have been paid by my clients under the judgment, yes.
If you speak about 10 million, this we can easily pay. But if you speak about 45 million, I cannot afford it. The 45 million is for the Ahli Bank of Kuwait. And you have previously asked Mr. Kurafi that why you didn't pay off the Ahli Bank of Kuwait, which is 45 million. That's why he could not afford to pay 45 million. But if you are talking about 10 million,
Mr. Brindle, we're going to be in a big mess unless you make it clear to the witness that the times at which this payment was to be made is quite different. And the 45 million that the witness is talking about is 2008-2009, I think.
Yes.
This statement is talking about 2014 and hereafter.
It is.
They're talking about two quite different time periods, and I'm not sure the witness appreciates that. The point, presumably, you're going to put to me is that this shows he's massively wealthy in 2014, but he needs to understand the context in which this statement is made.
Right. Well,
can I take him, which you have not explained to him fairly yet?
Can I take him to paragraph 8, which is this paragraph I was seeking to get to? The point that my lord has just made, perhaps you'll just pass this to the witness.
Oh, well.
is that this witness statement is dealing with 2014, not first sentence, the claimants are people of substance. Indeed, the judge found that all were wealthy. In particular, the second defendant, who inherited substantial wealth from her husband and family. Just translate that and see if he accepts and agrees with that. And a little later on, if you pick it up, about five lines down, it says, it is appropriate for the court to focus on her, that's the second claimant's position, primarily. She is the wealthiest of the three claimants and has very substantial property assets in Kuwait. Can you just translate that, please? And that was true not only in 2014 but also in 2009-2010,
wasn't it? Mr. Karabi says, compared to today, at 2008, my mother's financial situation was worse than today.
Well, you may recall, and I'm not going to go over this with you, that a lot of evidence was given at the trial by you and your mother about and your wife about the assets that you had available. You may remember giving a lot of evidence about that. Is that right? Right. Now, let's move on to the position in 2010 when the CBK loan was taken out. Do you remember that was September 2010? You are now claiming for interest that you have had to pay, when I say you, again, I mean, in fact, it's the second claimant, I think, isn't it? The second claimant has had to pay interest to CBK, and you're claiming that from my clients, correct? Can you explain why no claim was made in respect of CBK interest at any time until after the trial and judgment in this case?
Exactly answer the question in the form he wishes.
البنك الأهلي بفترة معينة أصر على بيع جميع الضمانات اللي تملكها الوالدة.
He said that at a certain point of time the Ahli Bank of Kuwait demanded that his mother should liquidate
Four, I say.
Okay, that the Ahli Bank of Kuwait is going to liquidate any assets given by his mother as collateral for the loan. You wanted to continue?
For طلب من المحامي مالي إن يلقى حل سريع لأن كانت رغبة الأهلي بالتسوية معدومة.
Then I asked my lawyer at that time to find me a quick solution because on the part of Al Ahli Bank of Kuwait there was no intention for a settlement with us.
فكان المحامي مالي اسمه باسم مغفر وهو شريك في كيري إتش.
And my lawyer at that time is Mr. Basim and he is a partner in KBH.
هو نفس الوقت محامي بنك التجاري.
And he was at that time is the lawyer for the Commercial Bank of Kuwait.
This is really just
getting into privilege. Really. Sounds as though it's getting towards privilege.
Fair.
I mean, just if you could just tell the witness that he doesn't need to tell us and shouldn't tell us, I think, about what transpires between him and his lawyer, what passes between him and his lawyer.
Can't you say that? أنا قاعد أوضح ليش إحنا اضطرينا نروح تجاري لأن كان في أزمة حقيقية ممكن يعني.
Mr. Kurapi says he was saying that because he's building up to a point he's going to explain.
Right.
Okay. To answer your question.
فالمحامي بخلال 48 ساعة دبر لنا طرد عشان ننقل أسهم الوالدة من التسييل من البنك الأهلي.
Then the same lawyer, Mr. Basim Muzaffar, and he was the lawyer for the Commercial Bank, he quickly, within 48 hours, he arranged for a loan for us from the Commercial Bank of Kuwait in order to stop the liquidation of his mother's assets by the Ahli Bank of Kuwait.
That was September 2010, was it?
So if it is written in the records, then it is. It cannot be recollected.
See, my question was, why was this not mentioned to the court at any time prior to the trial in
2013?
He said, Mr. Kurapi said he has mentioned that for his lawyer, Mr. Kashif, who passed away.
And you're saying, are you, that you mentioned it and your lawyer failed to pass it on to us and to the court? Is that what you're saying?
Well, you delayed
the
record.
The court was not
held
at it. And this matter came up in, what, January, February? January. And I ruled that we could have evidence about what happened.
Yes.
Because otherwise, as I ruled, get a windfall.
Yes, but it doesn't mean
you undoubtedly disagree with that ruling, but there you are.
No,
there it is. The there's no reason to doubt that the KBH canoe knew about it if the witness says that it was them who organised it. And I've understood the witness to be saying it was Mr. Bashir who organised it.
Mr. Kashif.
Yes. And he was your lawyer. He was the lawyer in this case, I think, at the time.
What can Mahami tell us about this?
Yes.
And I discussed this point with him in the presence of other witnesses.
Kashif was the principal of KBH Canoe.
Yes.
He died.
Yes.
Sadly. Just before this trial started. The trial started, I think.
A few months before.
Very shortly before the trial started. So there may well have been a lot of other things on his mind at the time, but anyway, it wasn't mentioned.
Yes.
There's no you can ask this witness if he told his lawyer to keep it quiet, if you like, but the fact is it wasn't mentioned. That's where we are.
I must be allowed to question why it was that this claim was never brought forward. Because, of course, my suggestion is going to be, and I'm going to put it, reason it wasn't put forward, rather like my earlier question, is because he knew full well that this couldn't sensibly be blamed on the defendants.
Yeah, well, you can put that to him.
And again, I'm sort of coming up. I thought I'd ask him, first of all, an open question as to why it wasn't revealed, but perhaps I'll come now to that. What I suggest to you, Mr. Al-Khurafi, is the reason why the CBK loan interest was not claimed from my clients or even mentioned until after judgment was because you knew full well that you couldn't sensibly claim any such sums as a consequence of the actions of my clients or the other defendants.
حسيت انه ما راح يكون في فايده منه هذا ما راح تقدر تجيبه للمحكمه بالله يعني اساسا بانك يعوض معنا
بقول له انا رجل اعمال وماني دين بالحسابات بس هذه المشكله هذه الفلوس اللي احنا اقترضناها من السي بي تي موجوده في سرسه يعني هذا المبلغ في سرسه كل المبالغ راحت سرسه يعني انا اذا في سبب مشكله بهالموضوع سرسه سبب المشكله فلما انا اسكر بنك الاهلي واروح البنك ثاني هالفلوس وين موجوده اصلا يعني سرسه فانا شلون ما اقدر اقول انه هم السبب
said the only party to be blamed for this is Saracen actually because they are the one who kept my money and they are the one who forced me to go and do other things go to the commercial bank of Kuwait and do other things and the only one to be blamed is Saracen it's obvious
Now, I'm going to move to one other thing on CBK. Last week, we were given, for the first time, some further documents showing that the loan, the CBK loan, had been renewed in 2012.
Is that right?
صريحة ما أعرف لأن في ناس ما استهل الموضوع هذا أنا ما مو على اطلاع على الموضوع تفاصيل إيش كثر اندفع إيش كثر ما اندفع تجدد هذه التفاصيل عندي ستاف متخصص بالموضوع أنا ما أقدر أفيد بالموضوع.
He said all the financial details are handled by my deputies and my team.
So you won't be able to answer the question then as to why we were only given this information last week.
ليش هذه المعلومة بس جاتنا الأسبوع الماضي؟ ليش وصلتنا هذه المعلومة الأسبوع الماضي؟
بعد إذن ساعتك القاضي أنا بلغت كل الناس إذا يسمح لي عدلتهم بلغت كاشف وبلغت مشرف وبلغت حتى البنك لما جو قابلوني قبل في سبتمبر اللي فات رئيس البنك الجديد قابلته وقلت له إحنا سوينا حطينا وشلنا فكنت حتى البنك عنده خبر رئيس المدير العام الجديد في البنك اسمه أدموميز بلغت بالتفاصيل هاي كلها وكلمته قلت له قال لي أنا جاي من مصر صفرة وقابلتك على أساس إن أنا الحين المدير الجديد وروحت مشى فقلت له قلت له أنا اقترضت من هني وسويت من هني فإذا نقدر نحل المشكلة بس على وقت فحتى البنك عنده خبر محامي عنده خبر وموظفين عندهم خبر كل البنك يعني كل الناس عندهم خبر.
Could you find it sensible enough that it was brought only last week? Because everyone knew about it. I have spoken to different people, Mr. Kashif, Ms. Bushra, and even the new manager of Saracen Bank who came and met me and explained to him in details that what we have done, And his name is Mr. Edmund. I met him in Jordan. He's the new manager of Saracen Bank. And I met him in Jordan and I explained to him in details what we have done to salvage what we have suffered from Saracen. We have been to the Commercial Bank of Kuwait and different people, to different things we have done.
Mr. Al-Khurafi, it's true, isn't it, that these documents about renewing the CBK loan only came to light last week and were only given to my side last week.
بس هذه المعلومة وصلت له الأسبوع الماضي.
هذا التفاصيل عند المحامين هذا مو شغل يعني.
Said you cannot refer to me about this matter. You can refer to my lawyers.
Right. Now, I'm going to pick up a point that I made earlier on. You remember I suggested to you. I want to now look at some of the detail of the ABK statements. Right.
راح أتكلم معك عن الفكرة الصفحات المصرفية تبع البنك الأهلي الكويتي وراح يرجع لك عليها مرة ثانية.
Yes, please.
And I want to explain to you why I put to you earlier that it was wrong to say that you were only claiming up till December 2009 because you only had statements up to that date.
رجع للنقطة الأولانية وقال لك أنتوا طالبتوا بكشوفات حتى 14 سبتمبر 2009. أنت قلت أن عندكم كشوفات لحد هذا التاريخ بس. بس هذه النقطة مش صحيحة حسب رأيي.
Right. So what I'm going to suggest to you is that the date of December 2009 is not in any case of any of the bank accounts at ABK a date up to which you had statements and after which you didn't. In other words, that date has no relevance to what statements you did and didn't have. Yes. Could you be given a bundle H3, please? I'm first going to show you, it won't take too long, I hope. I do think I have to do it. Three bank statements relating to your account, your personal account. And I'll deal with your mother and your wife. So, when this bundle arrives, if you look at towards the end of this, well, the fat bundle, is tab 149.
H3.
We will be looking at H2 a bit later on. I think all these bank statements are in H3.
Were these documents available at trial?
Yes. Yes.
They were?
They were.
So this point could have been made at trial? Or rather, the question could have been put to Mr. Graffiatron.
It didn't, in a sense, matter then, because there wasn't any claim for later interest. And so it didn't matter, as it does now, why he's not claiming for later interest. The fact of the matter is he wasn't. Well, even if it was a self-denying ordinance, then at least that protected us from that further claim. But now that he is claiming, it becomes relevant to know why he didn't make the claim earlier. Now, do you have that now, Mr. Al-Gharafi?
Yes, sir.
Tab 149, and this is one of your accounts, all right, and you see that the dates of the statement are from December 2006, this is towards the top left, to 31st December 2011.
Which page are we looking at?
Page 4684.
4684.
It's the first page, and I think the only one I need to show you, of this bank statement. It goes on for several pages. Do you have it? Once we get into this, it's going to become very straightforward. So tab 149, page 4684, top left-hand corner.
And then I shall.
He says he has it up to 2010.
No, it says 31st December 2006, to date December 2011. You see that? 11. So that account, and there are many others which I submit are the same, have dates not up till December 2009, but up till December 2011. Disclosed by the claimant. These were the ones that they were attached to the Griffin's report.
Yeah,
They came from your side.
Is there now this point is that actually you said is the statements were up to 14th of December 2009 and here they are up to 2011.
Exactly.
Okay, but if you said that Mr. Kurapi is short of giving statements, he said these are more.
These are what?
These are actually beyond the date you have mentioned.
Yes, you see, this shows, and there are many others, that in fact you had and disclosed to us statements going beyond 2009, and indeed going on for 2 years further into 2011. This is the documents you disclosed to us before the trial.
مرحلة كاشف مرحلة ما بعد كاشف مرحلة ما قبل كاشف ما طلبوا بالأشياء هذه مرحلة ما بعد كاشف طلبونا بكل اللي موجود دبرنا كل حاولنا ندبر ونكلم ونحاكي كان على أساس ندبر نجيب معلومات الماكسيموم اللي نقدر نجيبها.
Yes. Your lordship, you have to consider there are two phases. The phase before within the lifespan of Mr. Kashif and the phase after the lifespan of Mr. Kashif. Before Mr. Kashif passed away, Mr. Kurapi wrote statements up to 14th of December 2009. But after Mr. Kashif passed away, he had a new set of lawyers and he did his maximum best to gather from different sources all the documentation he needed. But at that point of time, Mr. Kashif did not ask for it. So Mr. Kurapi did not present it. But now, he and his lawyers, they did massive effort. And they used connections and relationships.
Kashif said that he was in the first stage. When he died, I sat down with the lawyers and went to them with a simple question. وجمعت لهم كل اللي اقدر اجمعه واللي قدر عليه جبت لهم اياه يعني ما في يعني انا ما قاعد احاول اخبي شيء.
Mr. Kurapi said that he is not hiding anything because when Mr. Kashif was alive, Mr. Kashif told Mr. Kurapi clearly that we are going to have two phases of trial. Phase one, we are waiting for a judgment. Whenever we have a judgment, then we need more documentation. And Mr. Kashif passed away before that day. But with the new set of lawyers, Mr. Kurapi presented them with all the documentation he has.
No, no. These documents that we're looking at, we've only looked at one so far, were documents which were put in before the trial. Right? We have not seen any other or earlier documents. These are the first and only ones that we have seen, and they were disclosed before the trial. Can you explain that to me?
أنا قدمت كل اللي عندي عن طريق المكتب مالي. أنا الحين إذا في أشياء هو أنت اللي تقولون إنه في شيء قبل 2010 في 2000 الحين في شيء علوم هذا الشيء لمصلحتي مو ضدي. فأنا يعني هل هذه كانت موجودة قبل؟ هل موجودة بعد؟ هذا مصلحتي ولا هذا ضدي؟ أنا ما خبيت شيء.
Mr. Kurapi says that he did not hide anything, whether it is against him or for him, he did not hide anything. All he had, he presented to the lawyers, and the lawyers handled the case. So you cannot deal with him about the technicality.
Let's just show you what a couple of other documents in the same
well,
time.
If you're going to show these documents, yes. I think it's only fair to show the last page, because we'll see when the entries run out. And you make the assertion that end of December 2009 is of no relevance at all. If you look at the last page, you'll see it's actually very relevant.
Yes.
And the problem about this document is it wouldn't support a claim for interest after 2009,
wouldn't
it?
Well, this is the interest after 2007-2009 is on the C3 account, which we do not have and have not produced statements for.
That's right, none at all.
We have produced some statements which on their face have dates after December
2009. Just like Mr. Brindle is putting to the witness that he concealed documents effectively.
No.
And if he's going to do that, it's necessary to show that this document actually doesn't support any claim after 2009.
I'm not putting that. What I'm putting is that when Mr. Karafi said that he could not give any bank statements after 2009, then that was just wrong.
Mr. Karafi didn't say that. It was the lawyer that said that in his opening statement thing.
Surely I should be allowed at least to pursue this matter.
You was just put to him fairly what this document actually shows.
He should put, if he's going to put things fairly, he should make clear that if he's saying that these are interest-bearing accounts are for the period after December 2009.
I'm saying that he cannot have been right to say that he could not produce bank statements after December 2009. This is a bank statement up till December 2011. No doubt about it. There may not have been much activity on the account after 2009. It's a different point in time. The fact of the matter is he had on this account, and I haven't yet come to the third claimant, where there really is no disclosure at all. The fact of the matter is he was able to provide bank statements up until beyond December 2009. He was able to produce bank statements up to 2011.
Yeah, but
well, that's the point I'm challenging.
He did produce these documents.
He did produce them, yes.
Yeah. So that these documents had been produced.
Yes, these were produced. My point is, my lord, that the 2009 being the date beyond which he didn't make a claim makes no sense.
Well, it makes perfectly good sense to me, Mr.
Well, according to the
document doesn't support a claim after 2009.
That's not what's said, Morgan. What's said is he didn't claim beyond 2009 because he didn't have any statements beyond that date.
Well, that's what his lawyer said in the opening statement.
Well, Lord, if your lordship's determined to allow Mr. Karafi to escape from that, then there's not much.
Well, you can ask Mr. Karafi if you agree with it, but that's what he's. I don't think Mr. Karafi has said this, has he?
Well, it's said on his behalf, and it was said. Similar thing was said in the trial transcript, which I won't put to the witness.
I put it in my judgment.
Yes, the Lord. This was the explanation given to us, and it's wrong.
And you have the document.
We have the document. We don't have any document at all for the important, by far the most important element of this. Mention, which is the third claimant's guarantee account. We have nothing at all, either before or after 2009. So 2009 makes no sense at all in relation to that one, either. December 2009 was the date when that guarantee was called. But we have no statements beforehand, we have no statements afterwards. So the suggestion that they couldn't give disclosure because they only had statements up to 2009 is obviously wrong in that respect. It's obviously wrong in respect of all the other statements because they did have accounts up until December 2011, albeit, which is a wholly different point, there wasn't any activity on most of those accounts between 2009 and 2011. That's the point I'm seeking to challenge. Now, the witness can always say, well, the lawyer said it and they were wrong. If that's his answer, then we'll have to deal with that in submissions. But in my respect submission, I am entitled to ask him whether that explanation given by his lawyer was a correct one. It was very clearly to him that it wasn't correct. And in my submission, this material shows it wasn't correct.
And where does that get you?
Well, that's a matter of submission, the law, but at the moment I'm trying to cross-examine. Unless your lordship thinks it's an improper question, which case I will note that.
No, what I'm concerned about is that if you're going to put this sort of document to the witness, you've got to do so fairly by showing him what it actually shows.
Yes, but this is in the context of my question relating to the explanation that they did not have bank statements beyond December 2009. This is itself a bank statement going beyond 2009. It goes to 2011, as in fact do, which I think I can probably pass over this, all the other statements except for the one of the third claimant that Maloney Friend has referred to, as to which there's nothing. Can you? Well, I'll.
That's not right. There is something to say. Tab 150.
Different account, I think. That's not the guarantee account.
No.
There's no.
The point is, as I said,
there's nothing from the third defendant on the guarantee account in relation to which $27 million was called, which gives rise to the great majority of the claim.
Well, you can see it coming in the last page of tab 150.
I think we'll get on with the evidence.
Well, can you explain to me, you may not be able to, Mr. Al-Gharafi, why we don't have, we say we don't have, any statements for the third claimant's account on which the 27.5 million guarantee was called?
سيلت قبل ما يجيك اختار من البنك فرسن فاحنا هو سيل وهو بس الان في يعني في بين هذا الموضوع في قضيه ليش ما جت كشف حساب ما كشف حساب انت تفاصيل معي
بس regarding this matter there is a case now before the courts in Kuwait against the Ahli Bank of Kuwait regarding the 27 million because they have liquidated the collateral put by my wife before they have a conclusive answer from Harrison Bank. And now there is a court case in this regard.
Can I just ask you to look at this tab 150 that Mr. Hill referred to? You'll see that this is page 4692, that towards the top left you have an account number. Right? You see that? It ends in 202. See that? Account number, and the last three digits are 202.
Yes, you can see it.
And that is not the account on which the guarantee was called, right? But on the second page, we see a reference to it. Last entry, the 14th of December 2009, debit 27.5 million, is referred to here, yes? And that's all we have in relation to the third defendant, third claimant.
Well, the position at the moment is that it seems to me this is not Mr. Al-Gharafi's bank statement.
No.
I've no idea whether Mr. Al-Gharafi has ever seen it before, whether his wife disclosed the bank statement to him, or whether he's any position to tell me what this bank statement shows other than what I can read myself. If you think he can throw some light on it from his own personal knowledge of his wife's bank statements, then you better ask him if he's ever seen it before.
Well, have you ever seen it before?
No.
Yeah.
You you have a power of attorney over your wife's bank account. You had a general power of attorney over her affairs, yes?
Mr. Barabas says that he has a power of attorney for his wife only to deal with the matters related to Saracen Bank.
Now, the claim that's made now against my clients for the interest payable in respect of this guarantee indebtedness was the subject matter, you say, I think, of a judgment or a certificate from the court in Kuwait, is that right?
So yes, there is a case filed by Mr. Qurafi and his wife against the Ahli Bank of Kuwait, asking that the Ahli Bank of Kuwait, they have liquidated the guarantee before they have got any official notice from Saracen Bank.
And you know all about that, don't you? Even though it's your wife's affairs in a sense, you certainly know all about it.
هذا راح سرسن في علاقة سرسن معي أنا هي هذا باسمها هي هذا باسم الوالدة وهذا باسمي أنا بس اتصالهم معي مثل ما خبرتهم من المحكمة الأولى عن طريقي أنا هذا أوريدي احنا تكلمنا فيه في قضية دكتور
He said the only thing that made him have any knowledge of this matter because this amount is actually given to Saracen Bank and that's why his wife and his mother they have given him form of attorney to deal with any matter related to Saracen Bank.
Now, can we look, you've still got bundle H3 there. Can you move on to tab 155, please? Sorry, Paula, can you just give me a moment? Perhaps trying to educate
you. Well, this is a document which is written in Arabic on 4781, I think.
Yes. Sorry,
Paula. My understanding is that 4700 is a translation by Sphinx Legal Translation Services of the Arabic document, which is at 4701. And since this witness will read Arabic as his first language, it may be that he should be referred to the Arabic version rather than the English.
Well, if I was capable of saying that,
if there is any difference.
Well, I'm not sure how he can, I can ask him to look at both the Arabic and the English, but obviously I can only question him, because I don't speak Arabic, on the translation, but as he looks at it, he no doubt should also look at the Arabic, in case
he has.
Yes, he has. Now, this doesn't make a lot of sense to me. You may be able to cast some light on it. First of all, what is it your understanding that this document exactly is?
هذا المستند اللي متعامل في دولة الكويت. نقول هالمعلومة هذه أول شيء. هذا المستند متعامل في دولة الكويت في وزارة العدل.
Okay, this is a document issued by the Ministry of Justice in Kuwait. This is a type of documents commonly used in Kuwait.
تشهد الإدارة العامة للتمثيل في وزارة العدل.
By virtue of this document, the Ministry of Justice certified that, yes.
البنك الأهلي رافع قضية على
ناصر الخرافي، علي الرفاعي وعمر الحمد بملف معين برقم معين بجلد معين بتاريخ معين بقيمة مبلغ 27.5 مليون دولار.
The documents have defined that the Ministry of Justice in Kuwait states that there is a court case filed against Mr. Ali Qurafi, Mr. Amra Al-Hamad, his mother, and Ms. Ali Arifai, his wife, in the amount of $27.5 million.
أكمل؟
Yes, please.
كله أكمل؟
He wanted you to continue, yeah?
وهذا العقد ذاك التوثيق هذا اسمه عقد تمثيل. هذا عقد رقم العقد مش عارف ليه رقم كذا إدارة توثيق العقار ملف تمثيل يعني إن لا إن هذا إن هذا المناطق هذا ملف تمثيل يقدرون يبيعون يرهنون يبيعونها يسيلونها وقت ما يبون هذا اسمه إيه ملف تمثيل ملف شو بالإنجليزي تمثيل ما أدري إيه فهذا ملف تمثيل على عامرة وعالية ورافض بهذا المبلغ.
The document can simply be read that it is said that the Ministry of Justice says that this document testifies that Mr. Qurafi, his mother and his wife, have a court case, and in this court case, the judgment has been issued that there is execution order to liquidate this property or this guarantee and use this money by order of the court.
الكويت يقولون ان هذا حكم تنفيذ القضيه شغل اخر بس احنا عندنا سيستم الكويت شغلتين المحكمه تمشي بس في نفس الوقت البنك يقدر ياخذ حكم التنفيذ وينفذ الى ان تخلص المحكمه بس يكون اوريدي باع الاسهم وباع العقار وكل شيء.
He said the judicial system of Kuwait, they have got two things. They have got the court which is in session and there is the deliberation in the court. But meanwhile, you can withheld a property or a guarantee, and you can have an execution order on it. And meanwhile, you can sell it, you can liquidate it, you can do whatever, in waiting for the court judgment later. So there are two separate things going at the same time.
How did it feel?
And this is the execution part of it.
See, tell me if I'm wrong. This doesn't. I think, does it say anything about any claim which you or your mother have yourselves brought? Does it?
It has a sort of factor or was filed for.
لا مكتوب هني تشهد إدارة عمل تنفيذ بأن يوجد في سجلات ملف تنفيذ كذا كذا ضدي أنا وأمي في البنك الأهلي هو الحين حاجز علينا وغير نفسه.
Mr. Quran says actually the court case is filed by the Ahli Bank of Kuwait against him and the other plaintiffs.
Against you, yes. It's against you. Because that's what it says in the middle. It says against Rafael, etc. And did this result from some contested hearing, some hearing where you argued the matter in court or made submissions to the court against Ali Bank or what?
Okay. قلت محامي ورحت المحاكم وقدمت أرائي وكذا تعرض على نفسي
هذا ما له علاقة بالمحكمة هذا أمر تنفيذ
هذا
ما له علاقة بالمحكمة المحكمة إجراء مختلف تماما هذه ورقة تصدر من إدارة التنفيذ إن فلان 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 فلاني وموقع عقد عقود الكويت بنوك عقود توقيع دائري يعني نفذ إميلي على طول فالمحكمة موضوع مختلف ممكن ياخذ له 5 سنوات 6 سنوات يكون البنك اوريدي سيل وخلص واخذ كل شيء.
Mr. Qurafi says he needed to explain to you how the system goes in Kuwait.
Yeah.
There are two separate entities. There is the agreement that you sign with the bank in Kuwait, then the bank is entitled by virtue of this agreement to liquidate any property or any guarantee given within the context of the agreement. This is one line. The other line, you have got all right to go to Kuwaiti courts and make a plea or make a submission and request that you have a judgment you want to contest or you want to file a court case. And the two lines go on. At that time, the bank have all right by virtue of the agreements itself to liquidate and sell the property. If you have got a judgment later, you can go back to the bank. But otherwise, the bank has got right from the beginning.
And this document relates to the first part,
of the
but not the second part,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
So, your arguments against the bank were not reflected in this, they're reflected in the second part of the proceedings, is that right?
Yes,
and have you disclosed to us any of those documents relating to the second part? See, as far as I know, this is all we have, this one piece of paper, in relation to all these proceedings in the Kuwaiti courts. There must be lots more documents under both the first and the second stages that you've described, isn't
there? He said, if my lawyer has asked about that, I would have given it to him. And I have given them whatever I have. So you better refer to my lawyers.
Let's see what this document actually then says in the bottom part of it. It says what the loan amount is, and by all means, have the Arabic to hand in case the translation is imperfect at any stage. But it gives the loan amount firstly, right? That's easy.
$27.5
He said the amount of the loan is $27.5 million,
right,
and it is due on 15th of December 2009.
Yes, now this is where you may need to look at the Arabic. According to the English, it says that the amount, not quite the full 27, but 26.8, is payable on the 15th of December. I want you to look at the Arabic, because my question to you is, it says it's payable, it doesn't say it's unpaid, or it just says it's payable. Is that exactly what the Arabic says?
هذه التفاصيل هذا موقف الحكومة ما أقدر أناقش أقول ليش كتبت وشو ما كتبت يعذرني إذا أنا مو قادر أفسر يعني.
Yeah, Mr. Brendan, he said that regarding this amount, he only went to the government official, which is the Ministry of Justice in Kuwait, and they have mentioned to them the amount of the loan. Whether the employees there have written 26 million, like 800,000 less or more, this is up to him. I only refer to the government institution and the rank that they have to write, and I accept it.
And then it says below that, notwithstanding the legal interest as per contract referred to, amounting $6.377 million.
Yes.
Now, do you know how that sum was calculated? You've no idea at all. But I suggest to you, because you've given us an explanation about the procedure and how it all works, there must have been some bank statements, must there not, from which whoever produced this certificate was able to calculate the amount of interest outstanding.
طيب لازم يكون الشخص اللي حسب هذه الفائدة يعني عنده كشوفات حسابه بعرف كذا طلع عليها بعدين وصل لهذا.
هذا اسمه المستشار محمد علي سالمي، هذا المستشار يعني قاضي.
نعم.
احنا القاضي بالكويت ما تقدر تكلمنا ولا تناقشه ولا تقول له وين جبت المعلومات، فهو وين كتب وين سوى هذا ما أنا بالنهاية هذا حكومة. ما أقدر أدخل عند القاضي وأقول له جيب وين كشف حسابه وشنو كتبت بناء على شنو. قاضي هذا ما كنت تتكلم معه.
Mr. Karafi says that, as you can see in the bottom of the document, there is the counselor Muhammad Ali Salmin. He is the one who has signed that document, and he is a judge. And in Kuwait and anywhere else, judges are not approachable. You are not supposed to go and talk to judges or argue with them or ask them, how did you come to this calculation? I could not do that. He is a government authority, and I just have to accept what they have written. That's what I'm doing.
I'm sorry, who is the judge?
Muhammad Ali Salmin.
Muqabi, Mustashar, Ali Muqabi. Ra'is,
his name appears where? On 4701. But I don't think it appears. Forgive me, Mr. Translator. If you look at 4701, you'll see that, ignoring for a moment the translator's stamp, which is at the middle of the bottom,
okay,
there seems to be a signature on the left-hand side, just above that, and another signature possibly on the right hand side, just above that,
yeah,
and is what looks like a stamp, a sort of duty stamp with a head on it.
Okay.
Which is the judge? Which signature? Which is the witness?
On the left hand side, your lordship, you have the judge's signature and name and designation.
Where do I find that on 4701?
On the left hand side, Your Honor, of the document.
That's the judge.
That is the judge, Muhammad Ali Salmin, the head of the
Executive Department. Could I just write that down? Muhammad.
Muhammad Ali Salmin, S-A-L-M-E-E-N.
S-A-L-M-E-E-N.
E-N.
He's the judge.
He is the judge, but Mr. Karami said that he's higher than a judge. He's a judge for who is
higher
the head.
Than a judge.
Not really. What? Excuse my English, your lordship. But he wanted to say that his position is the head of the judges.
Head.
The head judge.
Head
judge.
Because that name and that signature don't appear on 4700, I think. Could you just look at the previous page, 4700?
No, it doesn't, Your Lordship.
It doesn't appear on that page.
No, it's not mentioned.
So we have to look at the Arabic page to see that it's signed by a judge.
Yes,
Your Honour. Thank you very much.
Well, I think the interpreter is saying that what is said in the English is head of the Capital Execution Department, and I think that's what the interpreter is saying is the description given of this judge.
Yeah, his lordship is asking whether...
Oh, I see. That's the interpreter's reference to the judge's name.
Same title. The interpreter, I think, gave the same title when he described it.
Well, I've no doubt at all that the head of the Capital Execution Department is way above the judge. I've never aspired to being head of a Capital Execution Department. It suggests all sorts of powers which I don't know yet.
Now, Mr. Karaf, did you or your co-claimants, your wife and mother, play any part at all in the calculation of that sum of interest, $6.377 million. Did you have any input into that at all?
مثل ما
معنا قلت بالمحكمة الأولى
yes.
وراح أقول الحين التفاصيل والأرقام والحسابات أنا ما لي متخصص فيها وعندي ناس يقومون فيها أنا هذا الكلام
أريد أن أقول لك هذا مبلغ الفائدة الشخص حسب الوحدة حسب الوحدة وكلامها
القاضي شلون نوزع احنا
كله
احنا ما نبغى حتى نقابل هذا الشخص
yes. Said to you, Mr. Krabi says him, his mother, and his wife, they don't have even the authority to appear before the judge.
Well,
they just have to file for something and let the judge will decide.
I suggest
so
you that you
have no hand in this calculation.
No hand, right. I suggest to you that you could have, if you wanted to, objected or filed an objection in the Kuwaiti execution proceedings, if you had objected. Is that right?
لكم تعترضوا بشكل رسمي على هذا الحساب مثلا كثير او قليل كان ممكن ولا لا؟
بس في نقطة فاتت عليك هذه شهادة ان اللي موجود الان في المحكمة هذا موضوع هذا موضوع مختلف عن القضية اللي احنا رافعينها وداخل فيها الحرب مع البنك الاهلي وبعدين نشتكي هذا يختلف هذه شهادة هذه شهادة شنو شهادة؟ هذه شهادة فقط، هذه شهادة رأي القاضي الآن. أما المتبقي يحتاج مننا إحنا وقت يحتاج مننا هذا موضوع مختلف. بالنسبة للشهادة إحنا ما نقدر نحرك فيها ولا حتى حرف واحد.
He said, Mr. Brendan, that this certificate is actually issued by the judge, but it has no relationship to the ongoing proceedings in the courts. This is for the execution part of the matter. Because now we are dealing with two things. The execution part, based upon this certificate issued by the Ministry of Justice. But Mr. Kurafi, his mother and his wife, they have filed a court case in the civil courts in Kuwait. This is something else, entirely different. And that is going on now. And if you want me, I can bring you more documents on that.
Is it not right that this certificate by the head of capital execution would have been based on an expert appointed by the court who would have produced a report which the head of capital execution would then effectively certify. Is that right?
بقضايا مو عشان شهادة
yes.
الشهادة تطلع من الملف الموجود الآن بالتنفيذ من خبراء بالقضايا فقط
المحكمة.
بس أنا ماني محامي فلا يأخذ كلام يعني
Mr. Krafi says if you wanted to request for the appointment of accounting expertise or expert that is something for the court to decide it's not for me or for anyone just a normal civilian to go to the Ministry of Justice and ask for an expert. That is for the court to decide. But I have followed the standard procedures in Kuwait, and I have applied for a certificate, and now I have the certificate in front of you. That is done by the procedure for the execution part of the same. But regarding the court case, this is something entirely in the hands of the courts.
I suggest that you could, if you had wanted, have obtained access to the court file to find what the calculations were behind this certificate. Is that not right?
They
said, yes, you are right, but this one might take at least 3 years, because the procedures in Kuwait will take a long time.
Right. We move on to a different topic, which is CBK. Now, can we, if you still got H3, go back a little bit earlier to tab 144. Page 4638.
this is again, I think, a translation of an original Arabic document which comes later behind it. Is that right?
Yes.
And yes, and the date of this is the 22nd of September 2010, and it relates to a loan by CBK of 10.8 million Kuwaiti dollars.
Dinar,
so sorry. Yes?
Yes, you're right.
Now, and the loan was made in favour of your mother. Why was that?
وما كان عنده استعداد يتفاهم معنا، ما كان عنده استعداد انه هو يستنى على ما نحل مشكلتنا مع سعرتها. فاحنا شفنا ان دائما الوالده تخسر 11-12 مليون سهم من الورثه اللي اخذتها من ابوها، نحول على بنك ثاني عندنا علاقه طيبه معه مستعد ينتظر علينا على ما تخلص قضيتها مع سعرتها.
سيد اكشولي وي هاف ابلايد تو اوبتين ذيس لون due to the complications we had with Saracen Bank and the Ahli Bank of Kuwait threatened us they are going to liquidate my mother's assets with them and we are going to lose awful amounts of money due to that, and that's why we thought about referring to a bank with which we have good relationship and they are ready to wait for us until we solve our problems with Saracen Bank. That's why we opted to obtain this loan.
Why was it just your mother and not you as well?
Actually, the same facility was obtained by agreement with me and my mother because the Ahli Bank of Kuwait wanted $30 million from my mother, okay, and they wanted $7 million, right? 7 point something million from Mr. Rafid Al Khurafi. We have joined the loan of my mother and mine. And we have shifted to Commercial Bank of Kuwait so that we settle the whole loan for me and my mother
together.
And in the settlement of the same amounts taken from Ahli Bank of Kuwait, it is written in the settlement agreement that this is in settlement of Ms. Amra Al Hamad, his mother, and Mr. Rafid Al Khurafi.
Now, if we look at tab 156 and 157, look at 156 first. I think that these are maybe 157 to see. 156. Is an account statement in relation to this account. You see that, to turn it on its side, it's in English. There's Arabic behind it though, so you may want to refer to the Arabic, which is not, you don't have to turn sideways immediately behind it.
Yes.
And this shows, does it not? It shows, first of all, the debit of 10.697 million on the 29th of September 2000. 10, and it goes up till repayment of the loan, or payment of the loan, the last item, on the 31st of July 2012. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So this loan was repaid in July 2012. No, why not?
He said this loan is still running until today because we have a court case and we couldn't settle it.
That is because of an extension or renewal which was negotiated in 2012, is that right?
Have a
Well, isn't it right that that particular loan which we've been looking at was repaid? And I'm then going to go on and ask you about what happened in 2012. But that particular loan that you took out in 2010 was repaid in 2012. Is that right?
It has a partner, so it's a cartoon. He said no.
Let's look at some documents which we got last week in a bundle. Put away bundle H3 now and go to bundle I, please. So we can be taken to that. If that bundle is coming, can 218 is the tab, it's towards the back of the bundle. Yes, it's tab 218, it's towards the back. 4832 is the page number. It's an English translation with the Arabic behind, but this is what I was putting to you a moment ago. This was a new contract, was it not, entered into in about August 2012, granting a renewed and indeed slightly increased loan to your mum. Is that right? Well, I'm asking you about it. Do you know anything about this at all?
No.
You see, you said to me the loan wasn't repaid, but it seemed, I think you're the only person I can put this to, that in fact what happened was the loan was repaid and a new loan was then taken.
لما طلبوا مننا نروح نجيب من البنك ونقعد مع البنك انا قابلت المسؤول وسالته سؤال قلت له احنا سددنا القرض قال لا ما في تسديد في عندنا اشياء داخليه داخل البنك بناء على قوانين البنك المركزي وبعد التعديلات قاعد احنا نغير السيستم والاوراق مالتنا فاحنا ما سددنا هذا وما زال القرض موجود والضمانات نفسها موجوده
person in charge of this file in the bank itself, and he told me that his loan is not repaid. It's actually we have an internal procedure required by the legislative body in Kuwait who is overseeing the banks sector, and we are just making shift in the documentation itself, but the loan is there.
Are you aware that under this loan, unlike the previous loan,
your mother had to give a mortgage over some shares in NBK.
Actually says the explanation for this actually Ms. Amra Al-Hamad, his mother, had put guarantees before for the previous loan. But when we had this loan renewed or whatever done with it within documentation, the price of the shares fell down. So she had to put more collaterals.
So
to meet that.
So you do know about this renewal or new loan, don't you? You're now beginning to tell us that you do know about it.
He said they have never had a meeting in the CBK before. Mr. Abdullah Shafi, who is present in this courtroom, has had many negotiations with them, and they have this settlement. But Abdullah was only briefing me, but he is the one who was going there.
Mr. Al-Qarafi, you're trying to pretend, I suggest, that you know much less about this than you in fact know. Is that not right?
And I think that how I have answered with what I know.
You said you knew that your mother had to pay increased security because of the drop in value. You knew that?
هو قال ليش حطيتوا ضمانات زيادة؟ أنا جاوبت حطينا ضمانات زيادة لأن سعر السهم نزل. هو سأل السؤال جاوبت على السؤال المنطقي.
Mr. Qarafi said that you are the one, Mr. Friendly, who asked the question.
Yes.
You said why did you put extra guarantees for this loan? And Mr. Qarafi answered you that because the price of the shares fell down, so we had to put more securities.
See, Mr. Qarafi, in relation to this matter, that is the post 2012 CBK loans, we have no evidence in any witness statement from you or your lawyer. All we have is documents that we were given without explanation last week. Do you appreciate that?
So this is not true.
So where do you say that you had previously told us before last week anything about this loan extending beyond
2012? حق المحامي مالي حتى حق المحامي الجدد بلغت الكل بالموضوع هذا.
Then later on, I mentioned to the lawyers. And later on, I mentioned to Mr. Edmond, whom I met in Jordan. And he's the manager of Bank Saracen.
My lord, if I could interrupt, I do apologize. This question is actually put in a false basis, in that Mr. Al-Qarafi's sixth witness statement it does confirm that the CBK loan remains outstanding and interest continue to accrue. It's paragraph 10.
Yes.
So it was said that the loan was outstanding beyond 2012.
My question was about the new loan that was made in 2012, as to which we had no information until last week. That's what I put, and I suggest that that's perfectly right. We were not told anything about a new loan made in 2012.
don't have to answer that, I'm just answering the objection. Translate it in case you want to say anything more. While we're looking at this document, on the second page of it, in the English, at page 4833, you will see in the first paragraph, firstly, that the amount of the loan has increased. Not by a huge amount, but it has increased up to 11.1 million. Kuwaiti dinars. I suggest you did, Mr. Karapi. You knew perfectly well, didn't you? And this is a reference to the use of monies, the end of that, for the purpose of financing personal needs. No, it doesn't say that, or no, you don't know about it, or no, it wasn't for personal needs.
What happened?
Was it or was it not true that the purpose of this was financing personal needs?
Can you mention for him the difference, please, between the first loan and the second loan?
No, I asked the question again. Is it or is it not true that the purpose of this loan was financing personal needs, as is stated in the fourth line of page 4833?
Mr. Karapi says, are you speaking about the 37 million?
I'm speaking about the 11.1 million, which we've just identified in the second line.
This is the loan from Ahli Bank of Kuwait to Commercial Bank of Kuwait?
No, talking about, you only need to look at these four lines. Here
that's
is
not a fair way.
Well, with respect, my learned friend really ought to listen to the question. What this is recording is that CBK is the second claimant has applied to the bank for a loan of 11.1 million for the purpose of financing personal needs. And my question is a very simple one, which I suggest you're trying hard to avoid. Was it or was it not true that that one, 11.1 million, was for the purpose of financing personal needs? Please try and answer the question if you can.
He said, I can only answer you in one sentence. The loan we have obtained from the Commercial Bank of Kuwait is taken into settlement from the Ahli Bank of Kuwait. Full stop.
And I suggest to you what's stated here is in that document is entirely correct, is it not? In those four lines that I've read. Entirely correct,
isn't it?
ولا احنا استعملنا الفلوس بس هي سؤال مهم.
مستر كرافي wanted you to clarify something, Mr. Brendan. Are you referring to the purpose of the loan? Is it because it is mentioned for personal use, or are you asking how you use this for personal use?
I'm asking very simple question.
Yes.
What is there stated is true. The loan was required for personal needs. That is true, is it not?
احنا استخدمنا السداد من بنك الاهلي وبنك الاهلي قرض شخصي.
Yes, it is for personal use to settle a personal loan taken from Ahli Bank of Kuwait, if you consider this personal.
And this loan was absolutely nothing to do in any way whatsoever with my clients and any faults of theirs committed many years earlier, was it?
المبلغ اللي طلع من تجاري وين راح؟ أهلي. والأهلي رفع قضية علينا على فلوس اللي راح تسرس. فالتجاري سدد الأهلي قرض سرس. هل إذا هذا ما له علاقة بالسرس ما له علاقة.
He said it has all things to do with Saracen actually, because we settled the Ahli Bank of Kuwait loan because we have taken this loan and given it to Saracen. So the Saracen is the main cause of all what has been going on.
Thank you, Mr. Al-Karafi. I have no further questions.
Could I just ask the interpreter this? Is there any difference in Arabic between his and her? Or is it the same word for each?
No, that is, Your Honor.
Because when the translator has translated the Arabic document, he refers to his current account, and he treats the second party as being male,
yeah,
man, whereas actually the second party is a lady. Mrs. Al-Hamed.
Yes.
So, in the Arabic, is the word his or her?
Actually,
perhaps could you just find it in the Arabic? It's the paragraph which starts, the second party applied to the first party to grant him bank facilities. If you read the document as a whole, that seems to be wrong, because the second party is female.
The female, yes. Your Honor, when you say speaking Arabic about a male and female, it's entirely different. It's her and him.
Yes.
Okay. But at the same time, bank standard documents, they have got this tendency to write it with the male attributions, usually. So that's why it is like that.
Thank you very much.
No re-examination.
Thank you. Does that complete Mr. Al-Karafi's evidence then?
Not yes. He could be released.
You have no reason, neither of you wish him to remain. Mr. Black, you've finished your question. Thank you very much, Mr. Al-Karafi. Thank you for coming along this morning. There's no need for you to stay.
Come out.
Should go from here.
Well, one thing we might do from here is go and have some lunch.
Well, but I'm wondering
if you have a better scheme, you tell me.
Well, possibly, my lord, in that I'm wondering if in life
I'm sorry. Thank you very much, Mr. Interpreter, for your help, as always. There's no need for you to stay any longer.
Thank you very much, Your Honour. Thank you.
I'm wondering, in light of what Mr. Brindle suggested earlier, whether we might just draw stumps for the day now and return tomorrow. That gives my lord a proper chance to read joint statement, the Griffins, the last KPMG report, the last Griffins report, and the yet further KPMG report. And that will make things hopefully clearer to my lord and provide an easier basis to deal with it tomorrow.
that's one option, obviously. Alternatively, I could just plough on after lunch. But it may be that there'll be quite a lot of causing some irritation to my lord as we try to grapple with some of these figures that you just haven't had time to pre-read. And of course, the yet further option is to adjourn altogether for another date. That does have cost consequences and possible timing problems. I would hope we could still do it in a day tomorrow, now we've heard Mr. Al-Kharafi's evidence, but I have to say it will be quite a full day tomorrow.
I don't want to risk not finishing tomorrow, so I'm